Okay, welcome to the Bucky call for June 10th and 11th, depending on where you are on the planet. And so, Manu, how are you feeling today? And what do you anticipate to get out of this call?
Feel good. You know, I just, and appreciating and that we're all here. I mean, we're four. Four is already some kind of vertices of a structure. So we are here. We are going to be committed. And we are committed to progressing on this. And what I expect is, as usual, that, you know, we draw from it practical lessons to help us, you know, kind of position ourselves and do to the best of the many. So that's my expectation. So, Richard, how do you feel? What do you expect?
Very kind of invigorated out of a session I was at yesterday at the University of Calgary, my faculty group. And I listened to a presentation from a woman whose family originally comes from Kerala in India, southern India. And it was all about futures literacy. One of the first things she put up was something about predicting the future, and then asked us to kind of comment on what we thought about that statement. And my comment was along the line of, well, the first thing I'd do is replace the word prediction and replace it with process or regeneration. And that's what the whole presentation was about, to move away from absolute prediction beliefs into one that was more appreciating the process of regeneration into the future. And the future is a scenario of many things, not one thing. So anyway, I was invigorated because almost everything that was being said, without mentioning Bucky Fuller, was all about Bucky Fuller and his thinking. It gave me pause to be positive about what might happen in higher education circles. Maybe the wheel is turning in a direction that would be helpful to understand the kinds of things that we get to talk about on this session and other sessions. So that's kind of where I'm at. Hope to take away more of that kind of energy and turn it over to Joe. How are you feeling? What are you expecting to get out of tonight?
I'm feeling good. Just looking to build off last week's material. We covered quite a bit. We were talking about evolutionary systems, and you kind of was a little bit wondering where Bucky was going with things at one point, but was able to connect the knots towards the end. So that was a lot of fun. And an eye opener. Felt like I was also starting to see some macro trends. We talked a little bit about the Bronze Age. We also talked about steel and the digital age as well, and as well as the copper age. And so the use of resources over time and how they've actually done more with less. So it was good. It was a very good session last week. I had a lot of fun, and so I'm looking forward to kind of progressing a little bit more and trying to look for those macro trends that allow me to tune in. So that being the case, Steve, how you doing? What would you like to take away from that?
Well, checking in. I'm normally very excited to be here, and I'm wondering why I'm. I don't know. Maybe I just have been tired. Today's been a weird day. So, and it's the end of my day, and I'm just looking at that. I just really like how Bucky is constantly thinking in terms of systems. And so I'm looking forward to get some more systematic thinking going here. And I just love the idea of the macro and the micro, of looking out and looking in. It seems to me that most human beings and most of my life, I've just looked out. And so I'm enjoying looking in a little bit too. So, okay. So, and Susan, I got a message from Susan that she'll be joining us a little bit later. She has a client, and I haven't received any other communications from anybody else. Has anybody else received any communications?
No.
So with that, we'll just, we'll go for it. And we left off. I'm having trouble with my machine, with my fingers. The machine's doing fine. It's my fingers that are a problem. So
yeah, same here.
So we left off somewhere in here. And so we'll go for it.
Yeah, I thought it was page. I thought we got up to page 22.
Well, if we left off with the last human exodus, that's on page 17. Do you know what words you left off on? Because I would like to start where we left off last week, and of course I wasn't here.
Why don't we just start with the last human exodus? That's where we were.
Okay.
Because we talk about the Bronze Age.
Right.
Okay, good. Okay, so I'm all for rotating the reading around unless we have a consensus on some other plan. Manu, do you want to read for a bit here?
Okay, the last human exodus from the islands of Austronesia onto the mainland occurred after the last ice age about 30,000 years ago. On the first such exodus two ice ages ago, which was 1.5 million years ago, those humans who had mastered horses mounted them and living their own food, rice growing, sheep and goat herding, and on foot hunting and hunting brethren behind, rode northwest to hunt wild animals until the next ice age forced them to endure survival in caves of non-glaciated Western Europe. With skin and hair all bleached, they emerged and mounted horses 30,000 years ago to confront the westward on foot and on camel caravanning of the earliest Egyptian and Mesopotamian civilizations of written history. The later civilization probably developed from the Indian Ocean and Austronesian island atoll people blown westward on raft to a queen asset suits source of pitches for her Egyptian shipbuilding, which source the Egyptian called the land of Pun, which we now know to have been Somaliland, the Likis Odluli Gorge country, and B to Arabia blown by twin monsoon easterlies of the Indian Ocean and the Arabian Sea. The word pun in South African colored language means red, and the Red Sea is the Pun Sea. The pun as a pun of Phoenicians and later Phoenicians of Carthage and Rome Punic War. Can we come in here?
Yeah.
I mean, this to me just is not really supported by any of the things that we know today.
Yeah.
Because you haven't had artifacts of that old age in the Arabian Peninsula, and you have been there because of dunes and erosions, things will have been exposed. You haven't had it either on the probable road of the Himalayas and down onto Egypt. There is no support that the Egyptian civilization was supported from anything. The early initial Egyptian civilization was supported by our source anywhere outside of Africa. No way. So this is, to me, is really far-fetched. And if you look at all of the excavations and the things that were discovered after Bucky passed away, talking about Lucy in Ethiopia, and lately to Naledi in South Africa, is all placed squarely in the East African Rift and Southern African, the emergence of the Omo, nowhere else. I'm not saying that is this, but not yet. There hasn't yet been any supporting documentation to this thesis of Bucky. Yes, there's technology that support, but technology could be applied everywhere.
Yeah. So you're just basically saying that the history that he's talking about is probably not correct. Is that what you're saying?
Yes.
All right, cool.
I've been interested in that particular part of critical paths ever since I first read it way back in the 80s. And it's always intrigued me in terms of the possibility of that being correct, even though whatever evidence seems to be forthcoming always says no, says something else. But there was a certain amount of, for me, intuitive sort of naturalness to the idea of emerging out of those sort of water-based sort of regions of the world. And I'm still trying to, fully understand what was happening that would make what Manu was just talking about being the source and the evidence that keeps showing up as to being the original sort of beginnings. So anyway, I'm I respect what he's saying, but I've been trying to keep an open mind for the possibility that something might show up someday that suggests that maybe we're going to have to rethink some of these early history evidence positions. So I just I don't like to sort of come down on the idea that here's a place where we found where Bucky is wrong. I'm still trying to leave that open to the possibility there might be some kind of rightness to what he's talking about.
Well, and if you look at, to your point, Richard, Graham Hancock is coming up with all sorts of archaeological findings now that date back, pre 10,000 years, 11,000 years ago. And I don't think we really know. And it's interesting how Bucky got into this. I mean, he looked at the world so differently.
Yeah.
But hey, there is something that is, in my opinion, here, very important. Okay, we carry it by memes, okay? We carry it by memes, and hopefully these memes are supported by what you call fact. And we have to work with what we have, in spite of our imagination. It's also very, very, very tricky to just say, because of the atoll, we know of all the westward current from wherever into. We know that the circumvention. We know that, for example, in the southwestern Africa, all the conditions for emergence are there, and there have been theories. But we're talking about Homo here. And I'm saying that if we really want to go further, we also have to be open to the most evident at the time. And the most evident is clear. It is very clear. Here he talks about the bleach hair, the thing, and then it referred to pond as Somaliland. Well, there's nothing in Somaliland.
Yeah, I didn't know what he was.
I'm just saying that in the past 50 years, or the past something, there have been so much that has been exhumed. And that supports some. That's why, the sway has been played. It is not the theory anymore. It is, yes, there is theory until there is something overwhelming. And that's what we call the process of veritas. Veritas is you read, even written by Bucky, you can attack it. If it's not supported by something that is evident, now you attack it. You attack the theory until you find, either you find a breach or the theory establishes itself as the limit of what we know. But it shouldn't be ideological. No, I don't think so. We have to be open to say there's, Bucky is a person. No matter how intelligent he was, he's written volumes and volumes. He will say things, some of which are not going to be correct. Sure. So I'm ready to attack. I can attack it. And I don't feel anything saying that for as long as it's based on fact, I will do.
Okay. Any other comments or questions about that?
Yeah, the only thing I want to say is, in the spirit of dialogue, the concept of attacking is not necessary. The dialogue can draw out the evidence, and one can accept what's available today, but the dialogue can also point to an openness, if you want, to something else might emerge at some point. That's all I'm saying.
Yeah.
I agree with you, Richard. It doesn't mean that I don't. I'm not ideological about anything. I'm just saying, when there seems to be more evidence, let's say, because that is based on what has been. It's like chipping, you know, roughness somewhere and replacing it with something, or rust somewhere and replacing it with something that we think fit better. It doesn't destroy Bucky's. I don't think that's why Bucky says it's a speculation. He wrote it here very clear. It's a speculative prehistory of humanity. We shouldn't attach any dogmatic value to it. Cool. He said really what looks to him at the time where he is as a plausible thing based on generalized principles. You know, if I apply it this way, this is a story I can tell.
Well, yeah, he was being a little bit narrative here, because even he says, with skin and hair all bleached, they emerged and on mounted horses, right? 30,000 years ago. So I don't know. You know, he's obviously telling a narrative, and that's interesting. So, and it's open to archaeological discussion. So we're going to continue to read, if that's okay. We're going to go past this map. Was on two different pages, and so I kind of stuck it into one page. If I tried to move this over here, I think I have it frozen. I think I have it locked.
I think you pass it, because we already talked about this map. I don't know if there's any other reference to it.
Then you did already talk about this?
Yes.
Well, then So do we want to continue with the discussion of the Dymaxion map, or do we want to go down further?
Unless some other people want, but the Dymaxion map is there, but it was referred to on another page. Unless we have something else to
19 see. And 20 says, if you look at my Dymaxion world map, in which we have noted before, there is no visible distortion of the relative shape or size of any of the land or watering pattern. Have you guys already read this? You'll find.
They might have, I haven't, but
yeah,
you'll find there last week.
Yeah.
Okay, let's read. Can I take it from there?
Yeah.
Okay.
If you look at my Dymaxion world map, in which, as we have noted before, there is no visible distortion of the relative shape or size of any land or water patterning, you will find 100 dots, each representing 1% of humanity as of 1980, after death. This is, each dot represented 44 million human beings. Each 1% is carefully located in the demographic center of each 44 million grouping of Earth's total people. You can see on my map that within an area that is only 8% of Earth's total surface, known as the Orient, which contain India, China, and Southeast Asia, 54% of humanity exists. Of this 54%, 8% has as yet islanded or peninsulate water people. Japan, 3%, Philippines, 1%, Java, Sumatra, etc., 3%, Singapore and Lower Malay Peninsula, 1%.
Let's pause. For a second and look at that map. So here's the map, and here's his dots, each representing so many millions of people. And this is really an interesting way to look at the globe. I love the fact that this has no distortion in land mass or water mass. I just think it's miraculous. And I wish that I'd learned about this map when I was in school. So, okay, I just wanted to come back and look at that map and notice that those dots, how he has the dots motivated around, and then again reiterated are the percentages down here. Each dot represents 44 million people, South America 6%, Central America 1%, North America 7%, Africa 11%, Europe 16%, Asia and land and water 61%. Okay. So I'm good with that. Anybody else want to look at that map for another minute?
Well, the only thing that is there is that percentages are varied today, but it's still that the majority of the world population is still concentrated in that India, China, South China Sea triangle.
Right on. Here's the peninsula water people. Interesting. Yes. As yet islanded, very strange way to do anything. And we left off somewhere around here. I think Singapore.
Yeah. Okay. Off. Singapore and Lower Malay Peninsula, 1%. Going on the globe westward, following the sun and facing into the prevailing north and southwesterly winds, we observe Asia Minor, Africa, and Europe with 32%. And then west and the Americas with 14% of all humanity. Kipling wrote in 1900. East is east and west is west, and never the twain shall meet. All who read him thought Kipling was obviously correct. No one in 1900 could foresee the as yet uninvented airplanes, let alone 350 passenger carrying 500 miles per hour intercontinental and around the world flying jet airline. No. Satellite relaying intercontinental telephony. Any comment on that? I think is very important. Can I give my comment?
Sure.
Okay, the comment is that, you know, when you are local, you cannot see the global, and your local reality can really distort your view of what the global is, because it's given there on a Dymaxion map. You know, a continuity of the landmass. And indeed, east and west are touching. Not as Kipling say, they don't touch. And that is quite different. In terms of, and as we discussed before, that will come to play in terms of how do you share resources or how you distribute resources? How do you deploy whatever you call capital in order to achieve the maximum or the best in terms of well-being globally. Because, you know, according to this map, Africa and Europe is the same place, isn't it?
Yeah, it's beautiful.
Yeah, what's exciting for me when I got to know that map, it also helped me understand, going back to the Malthusian discussions that Fuller talks about so often, as to why Indian people in India ended up being called East Indians because of their location in relation to the so-called center at the time, which is the head of the British Empire. And why they still continue to refer to themselves very often as East Indians rather than Indians. And the other one was when I was had a position in Bombay, India, and I would talk to my students if they could come, if they could fly from Bombay to Calgary or from Calgary to Bombay as the crow flies, what direction would they be flying? And it was very interesting to discover that if I was in Calgary, I would fly north over the North Pole and then south to Bombay. And it's almost identically halfway around the world. And then if I was in Bombay to get to Calgary, I actually fly exactly the same direction. I fly north to the pole and then south to Calgary. And for some reason that always really fascinated me, that the direction to the other side of the world, so to speak, was north and then south, and the reverse was the same direction, north and then south.
Mm-hmm. I love this. What came to me is he took the map. Normally, I'm looking across the equator, and basically he switched it 90 degrees. So now I look up over the pole. And that 90 degree change in perspective changes the whole look of the planet. I just thought that was kind of interesting.
And the other thing that's interesting about that, I have a puzzle here with all 20 pieces, 20 triangles. And what you can do is you can rearrange the puzzle. So wherever you are in the world, what sort of land you're on, you can rearrange the puzzle so it looks like your place in the world is the center of the world. And it's kind of fun to see how you can do that. And it sort of reflects a little bit on how common it is for any one of us to say, where I come from, my place is the best place in the world. So whether it's, you know, Canada is the best place, Africa is the best place, US is the best place. And the puzzle allows one to actually rearrange things so that if that's what you feel, you can actually rearrange the earth or the map so that that's the perception.
What's that puzzle called, Richard?
It's a Dymaxion map puzzle. I've got it here fairly handy, I think.
Can you find it on the web somewhere?
I don't know. I bought it in a store, and I don't even remember where I got it, or somebody gave it to me as a gift. But it's kind of a fun map, and it's a map that I used to give to my kids when they were young and our grandkids, and it got them, helped them sort of get a different kind of vision of the earth, the mapping of the earth, than what you would get in a normal school Mercator type of map that does have distortions.
If you can find the SKU code on that or the name of it, I'd love to look for it. I'd love to have one of those. I'd love to give it to my kids because I love the idea of me knowing, you know, the Chinese symbol for China is a rectangle with a line down the middle of it at 90 degrees. So it looks like a rectangle on an axis. And it means it's the center of the world. To China, to the Chinese, China is the center of the world. Good. Do you have a SKU code or some kind of a...
Yeah, I'll start looking for it, yeah.
Good. And if you could plug it into the chat, that would be really, really cool. My grandkids would love that. Wow. I'm excited. Any other comments or questions?
No, not at this time.
All right, we'll go ahead and continue to read. I wish that whoever made this PDF file did not do a very good job of getting in the crevasse of that double truck right there. And so this is the best I could do to put it together, but obviously the North Pole is, Alaska is not properly represented, and the Aleutian Islands. I guess that's Siberia. That's the end of Siberia, and that's Japan coming over there. So I don't know. There's some distortion there in the middle, and I don't like that. So I sure hope we can find that map. Oh, crud, did I lose my place? Did we finish both of these paragraphs? I think we did, right?
No. Yeah, I finished the second one. looking.
Okay, good. Joe, do you want to read starting with looking closely?
Looking closely at this area, we see the Indus River rising in the Himalayas and flowing westward to Karachi and then into the Arabian Sea. Then, starting in almost the same high Himalaya place as the Indies, we see the Ganges flowing initially westward, then turning eastward and flowing south of the Himalayas to the Bay of Bengal. Next, we note the Brahmaputra River, I hope I'm saying that correctly, originating within 100 miles of the sources of the Indus and Ganges and flowing first eastward, then southward to penetrate the Himalayas, whence it flows also to the Bay of Bengal. Then we note the Salween, the Mekong, the Yangtze, and the Yellow Rivers, all starting from approximately the same geographical source atop the Himalaya Mountains, an area so small that my forefinger tip can cover it on my map. Thus, 54% humanity over 8 times the population of North America is.
Hang on, here we go.
Watered from the same reservoir, the frozen Himalaya reservoir, which melts just fast enough to keep things growing and life going on through ages and ages and ages.
So what is interesting to me is he sees glaciers as a reservoir. Basically, isn't that interesting? I mean, he sees everything based on actually how they work in the system. The fact that 54%, you know, they all come out of that little place, the Himalayan mountains where all these rivers start, and that the ice pack is a reservoir. He looks at it like it's a system. It just boggles my mind. Any other comments or thoughts, sir?
That's the value.
Go ahead, Joe.
No, I think that's the value of taking a macro perspective and starting. I don't want to start this conversation again, but starting with the whole and the idea that you're actually, you're looking at all possibilities. So you start to see, you know, exactly. All the possibilities where the water goes and how you can use it most effectively.
I never knew what astronesia was. I never knew. And there was a map I thought I was getting to here, but it's everything between the Asian continent and Australia, Austronesia. Evidently, there it is right there. Whoa, okay, cool. There's Austronesia, the Hawaiian Islands, New Zealand, and Madagascar, along with Indonesia. I didn't know what Austronesia was. I thought maybe that would be helpful for you guys. It certainly was helpful for me. I looked it up on my phone while we were talking because I'd never heard of it before. Wow. Any other thoughts or comments or questions?
My comment was the general thing that you take from what is described is that all waterways are from high point. And that to me, that's what it is. And if you look at the world from east going westward, for example, you know, on that landmass, you see that is true. That's true in Asia with the Himalayan system. That's true in Africa with the East African Highlander, you know, where you have Kilimanjaro and Mount Kenya and the Rwenzori, the biggest rivers, the Nile River, the Congo River, the Zambezi, they get the sources from there. And then when you go westward, you go to the Western African plate, to where it meets the I wouldn't say the East, it's at the junction with the South Atlantic ones. You know, I'm talking about areas, no, North Atlantic plate, in areas like Senegal. You know, you have the high mountains of Guinea, and then from there you have a Niger River flowing, and then you go to South America, you know, from the Andes flowing down, you know, you take the, you know, the Amazon River. It comes, it starts from the Andes, and you go to the US, you have the Appalachians, to a lesser extent than the Rockies, being the sources, and then the lake areas. No, actually, they're flowing to the lakes. And the Appalachians and the Rockies playing a very important role in sourcing, you know, fresh water that flows through the rivers. So to me, that is the general thing that I take from this, rather than the description, is that water always flow down as rivers from high point. And the role of high point is it can be the condensation role. You know, it doesn't go up to the glaciers. It just go up, you know, like you have hot, when you have, you know, in the equatorial areas, for example, it goes up, water, you know, hits, air, you know, is, you know, elevates, and at a certain altitude, it condensates and falls as rain. And that is what I get from that description.
One of the things that, just to take off on what Manu is saying, that the headwaters of the Missouri and Mississippi are right here in my home province of Alberta. And the river flows east and then south to the Gulf.
Yes.
Cool.
And so it's important that what you do, Richard, affects somebody in Louisiana.
Yeah, and if you just keep your fires to yourself right now, New York would be okay.
Oh, that's right. We're just showing you how we can invade. and the next one, we'll just shut off the tap up in the Rocky Mountain houses, and that'll empty the Mississippi in a couple of days.
Yeah. Wow. Unbelievable. The Canadian invasion.
That's right. Yeah. And we've got our fingers on the Columbia River too, and probably the Colorado River, but it seems to be drying up on its own without any help from Canadians.
Yeah. Cool beans. Any other comments, questions, or jokes that anybody wants to put in? Okay, Joe, you want to continue reading?
Sure. Where was I? As the water people came out of the ocean islands habitats and began to ascend those rivers and carried aloft their canoes around and above the rapids and waterfalls, they could not help eventually discovering the common regional source of this comprehensive life support water. In the present critical unrest of our world, where we find the greatest ideologically warring powers on our planet puppeteering through Vietnam, the dissensions into warrings of Cambodia, Laotians, Thais, and Burmese, that's Laos, essentially. Yeah. It is clearly seen that the only differences between the Southeast Asian peoples and the rivers by which they go inland and upland to the same source of supporting water. It is easy to understand why the Dalai Lama was located in Tibet at the source of all their water. The source epitomized God as the physical life giver and taker. Looking at Southeast Asia on a metallurgical resource display map and coming north in the Gulf of Siam to the mouth of the Chai Phara River. We note that in the Malay Peninsula, there are vast amounts of tin ore all the way from Singapore to Burma and northward inland in Thailand along the Chao Phraya River to northern Thailand. Then, altering our direction, we go a short way eastward and descend from the mountains of Laos, which are everywhere rich in copper ore. Everywhere along the east bank of the Chao Phraya River lies copper ore, and everywhere along its west bank lies tin ore. At Bangkok, on the Chai Phara River, I don't know if I'm getting this right, I find the most extraordinary history of the development of wooden boat buildings as yet manifest on our planet. I remember how back in 1958, as I went along the canals leading off from the Chai Phara River, I kept discovering shipyards. In all America, there are less than 50 boat building yards now in operation. But in Greater Bangkok alone, I saw more than 1,000 boat yards.
100.
I'd like to know that. Forgive me. 100 boat yards. I'd like to see the size of those boat yards though, too. To the boat yards of the Chai Phi Phara River and its canals, the logging people inland and upstream bring seaward with the current and tides, great teak logs, which are towed together in enormous inner tide rafts. As we get into the Bangkok region, we see the great teak log rafts moored wherever there is spar waterfront. The shipbuilders usually keep the logs soaking for up to 100 years before using them in their ship hulls. After a century of soaking, the teak becomes highly stabilized structurally. They then haul out the dry logs sufficiently for their shipbuilders to work them into the log planks and frames with their metal tools. In all my boat building experience, of which I've had a lot, I have not found any craftsmen sawing out long, delicately curved ships plankings and planning them with greater accuracy than in Bangkok. They make their planks so carefully that they fit watertightly together without any caulking. They dry teak just enough to fashion it into ship planks. But the minute the ships are launched, for instance, as great rice fighting hulls, enough moisture gets back into the wood to swell the planks water tightly together. Is that supposed to be two words? What also fascinates is the incredible amount of rice being brought out to feed civilization, stored sometimes for months in boats, belly holds, which are absolutely dry tight and never painted. The Thais have had thousands of years of such boat building experience. The entire evolutionary history of great boat building is as yet manifestly alive on the Chao Phraya River. Every instance of the progressive stages of its evolution, from watertight teak bins mounted on rafts to the big ribbed deep belly ships found in use there today, is in live operation. Anyone who is a sailor knows that ships have to have powerful and enduring fastenings of many kinds, nails, screws, and rivets, to hold fast that the tweak planking to the ribs, and myriads of rope cleatings, chain plants, etc. Nothing could better serve as fastenings than non-rusting bronze. Those Thai sailors and boat builders were the first to accidentally marry copper and tin to produce bronze, and thereafter to use it purposely in shipbuilding coppers. First great structural functioning came when combined with tin as bronze fastenings in ships. I am absolutely confident that Bangkok is the center of the beginnings of the best ship technology and design engineering of a world around civilization. Prototypes of every type of hull, from gondolas to barges, are there, including the prototypes of the powerfully ribbed, deep-bellied ships that the Phoenicians sailed across the Indian Ocean and to Mesopotamia, where the Garden of Eden story is played. When they attained big rib ships, their sailors went readily out to sea, whence their island forebearers came. These improvements allowed them to go more directly into the wind. They could beat at a 22.5 degree angle either side of the wind and work to windward rapidly. The seagoing traffic extended at the first to the Malay Straits, then spread out into the Indian Ocean. As the interchange became different nationalities increased, so also each began to copy the best features of the other's craft. The ships became composites of some total experience gained throughout the general area. The merchants moved westward into the Indian Ocean, whereas reverse winds during the monsoon. But by this time, they could go counter to the breeze. Thus, it was the Western Indian Ocean reached the Persian Gulf, the Red Sea, and the east coast of Africa. The men who as yet handled these dhows are extraordinary. They assume that their trade has been in continuous existence for at least 10,000 years. Their navigation must be meticulous, considering the period that it would have necessity take to develop such vessels as theirs and to establish such a circulation. There is no reason at all to doubt their estimates. Among ships, the dhow still sails the sharpest angle into the wind. This is the advantage of the triangular laden sail, which is long spar attached to its short mast in such a manner that their angle of incidence is 45 degrees. The front of the spar is heavier than the rear end, which projects into the sky. The balance is so extracting, however, their sheen does not have to be very rigid, and the mass can act as a fulcrum.
Are you guys getting a picture of what these things look like? Because I just looked them up on my phone, and they're quite interesting ships. We've seen these in the movies. Do you guys know what they look like? Because I sure didn't. Let's see.
Have you got one there, a picture?
You should show it.
I'm going to show you a picture. D-H-O-W and images. So here's the, right here, Dow definition. There's one right there. That's what he's talking about, are those ships. So I just thought that was really interesting.
Yeah,
it's very interesting.
Cool. So let me see. I'm just going to take a screenshot of that. And we'll go back over in here. Any comments or questions so far?
I think it's a beautiful story that is telling the how you get into more general, but from your particular experience. First, tin and copper to make bronze. Bronze that doesn't rust. And then you have, the treatment of logs by immersing it for 100 years.
Yeah.
And then come up there really hard, and you put it together with that caulking. That is in itself, a really, really big achievement. Yeah. And then later on, because there are rivers and then people diversify in other ways, you have now they cooperating again, and you have the composite of different local experiences that come to the improvement of the dough or something like that. I think it's a beautiful story about the process.
The other thing that's really, what I always found intriguing with this part of the story is the reference to the Bronze Age, which is taken for a given in many respects. But he points out that it had to start somewhere where tin and copper were close together enough that you could accidentally see the combination that would eventually become bronze. So he's always going into starting points, like, so where did bronze come from? Well, it came from a part of the world where you could find tin on one side of the river and copper on the other. And it was a serendipitous accident, maybe, or intuitive sort of innovation that somebody did that tried to combine these two ores together to produce something that then became very, very important in the history and the development of nations and civilizations.
You know, I feel, hearing this, I feel gypped because, when I went to school, it was some, I don't want to get too political here, but it was some guy that invented bronze. You know, the idea that you'd have bronze because tin was on one side of a river and copper was on the other side of the river, and somehow somebody put them together, just is so magically natural. You know, it doesn't take white genius to pull that off. I am real frustrated about how history and sociology and however Bucky's facts are, which could be backed up or refuted by a certain amount of geology and paleontology, his way of looking at life is so practical. It almost makes system thinking obvious. There was copper on one side of the river and there was tin on the other side of the river, and somebody maybe was doing something one day where they didn't have enough tin, so they threw the copper in to build their thing, and all of a sudden found out 100 years later that bronze thing lasted longer than the copper thing or the tin thing. I mean to me it's just very cool. Whole history of human beings. Go ahead.
I was just going to say it's also that story. The only difference is the drama that is put into telling. It is also that somebody was trying many, many things, many combinations with something that was available and accidentally came upon something that proof of a higher value.
Yeah.
When I mean value, it's higher use, something that doesn't rust, for example.
Yeah.
Right. But the most, one of the most important point that I see here is the issue of what we call globalization and industrialization. Mm. Right? If you talk about globalization, then you come into an exchange when they are extractive of resources that are raw from an area to take it into another area where value is supposedly added. And the guy who produced from where they have, he has nothing. He just has some paper, some notes, some money given unto him, right? He doesn't go through the process of learning by experience.
Mm.
How to use the process. Industrialization is actually the practice of the principle into producing things that are standard for consumption. I'm inventing this. I'm not saying that it's correct. But I'm saying that's the feeling. So when you put those things together, you see how now places like Bangkok, and Joe was talking about the size of those shipyards, how it's been destroyed. I mean, there are places, you wouldn't believe it, in West Africa, right? Where you go, you get everything that you want. It's in a dump, but there's industrialization in it. It is polluted. It is densely populated. And they produce things that they use. You know, it's not sophisticated as a transistor, but they are able to recover some chip somewhere, put it together to do things that are useful to them. And to me, that's the only way that you actually develop in a way that is consistent, in a way that you have some kind of appreciation and maybe comprehension of some general principles. There's no other way. Somebody cannot come and tell me that the transistor is like this and a book, and I just know what it is. I have to cut it, or I have to right. put it together with something and sense it to see how it works.
Are you complete?
Mm-hmm.
I have real trouble believing that anybody could soak a log for 100 years to figure out that it's seaworthy. I mean, nothing lasts 100 years. I mean, doesn't everything happen in 15 minutes, in 44 words or 15 minutes? I don't know. I just, 100 years, they soaked a log for 100 years. Good grief.
It is because we are so adept.
Yeah.
I'm forgetting about the shoulders of giants that we rode.
Yeah, that's correct. We're
very adept at doing that.
Yeah, no kidding. Okay. Oh my gosh, I thought I was going to remember where we were. It's somewhere in here.
No, God. Irate meaning God. This God.
Okay, down to God. Okay.
I'm sorry. Yeah.
Yeah.
So.
Do you want to let somebody else read? Or do you want to continue reading, Joe?
I don't mind continuing reading.
Susan should read.
Unless somebody else would like to read.
I suggest Susan.
Okay.
In the I've been early, nominated.
In the early drifting with the current and prevailing wind days, a large migrating of humanity occurred within the Pacific. The rafting colonists were swept along the coast of China into the Bering Straits by the Japan Current. There is a bridge of land between the continents contributed considerably to the overland migration from the Orient to the coast of North America. The Japan Current carried the rafters to Alaska. It carried them to Mexico and Central America. It carried them to Colombia, Bolivia, and Peru. Thereafter, the same current swept them back westward across the Pacific and back to Austronesia, as Thor Heyerdahl proved with his raft Kon-Tiki. Which I'm sure there's newspaper clippings.
Yeah. There's a movie on it too.
What's the movie called?
The movie's called Kon-Tiki.
Okay, there. Should have guessed that.
Yeah, that was a big deal for Mormons, because Mormons believe that people migrated to South America the same route that the Kon-Tiki took.
Hmm.
Cool.
As sailing into the wind, people headed westward from the Malay Straits, they crossed the Indian Ocean, arriving in Mesopotamia and on the east coast of Africa. From there, they traveled overland to the Nile. Over 10,000 years of continuous voyaging across the Indian Ocean by the Dhow Sea captains evidences the deep-bellied, heavily keeled and ribbed engineering of their craft and its seaworthiness, and locates the origins of sea technologies in the area of Ban Chiang. Not sure where Ban Chiang is, but all civilization had its origins in the network of maritime interlinkages of early cultures. Tension capability is newly manifest in seagoing born tensorial skill and intellectual capability. Compressional capability is manifest of the land-born stone ages and the inertia of stone walls. At sea, humanity entered into true technology, that of powerful tension interfacing capability. Bangkok itself is the prototype of all canal cities developed by later water people around the world. For example, Venice and Amsterdam. Sampans are prototype of Venetian gondolas later brought covered by the Phoenicians to Venice. Bangkok seems to be the prototyping locale of the big keel, big ribbed, deep bellied ships of both the China Sea and
Wow. Did I leave off a page? I think I might have left off a page. I don't know. There's page 24 and page 25. Let's talk for, I'll do some little research on it. I wanted to talk.
Maybe a paragraph.
Yeah, I wanted to comment on this idea of, he used the word tension capability is newly manifest in seagoing born tensional skill. So this whole concept of tension and tensegrity, you know, the idea of invention and navigation and progress by using tensorial principles, you know, to me, that's just so, so cool. I'm going to
the other thing that's exciting about that, and again, I've obviously read that chapter a long time ago, or that paragraph, but now it's coming alive in a different way, because as he talked about being on land, it's compression. If you're trying to get to another land mass, which is compression, then the sea actually and the water movement creates the tensional connection between the two land masses, or the two maybe different peoples. And so there we are with land and sea working together in a tensional integrity kind of way. And the human function, if you want, the function of being human was able to sort of use their mind to figure out how to take advantage of that natural compression tension dynamic that existed in the lands and the waters. I've often used suspension bridges and human anatomy and whatnot as the example of compression and tension and tensional integrity, but I never saw it this big by way of an example or analogy.
You know, to me, as far as we talk about our role and that of technology that is designed, and Bucky talked about anticipatory design, it always flows from I would say that the local experience is so good, is so important. But most importantly, is to understanding how does that local experience, you know, fit with the generalized rule. And you say you wouldn't get the importance and tension until you are faced with the problem of solving something. Right? It is at sea where you have that turbulence and those movements that the importance of domesticating the tension to build something that is anti-entropic to that risk, right? Prove its importance. And that's where technology application should be. And it meets what I think in terms of education and knowledge and everything. As for as long as you don't marry practice to knowledge, it is useless. Help us into our role of really basic solver problem in support of the integrity of the eternally regenerative universe.
Cool. I am putting the Contiki movie film thing in the chat. And I found the last three words, Susan, so that you can actually finish the reading and feel victorious. There's nothing worse than having literary interruptus. So there's your last three words.
There you go. Of both the China Sea and the Indian Ocean.
Yay. Thank you. I'm so sorry that I messed it up. Now, Bucky is...
And as Richard was saying, you know, the how long it took, but anyway, people learn to take advantage of the natural things appearing, you know, like the current.
Yes.
When they occur. And copper and tin on two sides of rivers,
yeah.
Harvesting those, building something, and putting it to use over long distances, over vast oceans, in a way to arriving at some place. Because we seek that mass, we seek the gravitational, we seek the compressional. That's where we rest,
right?
So we're driven by that towards it. And it's interesting that you say tensegrity. We understand it as tension, compression, integrity, but the compression is, in that word, it is, how do you call it? When the word is sure, is silent. The same linguistic schwa, I think, to say, you know, you have something that is written, that could have been written something, but in the spelling of it, you silence it. So tensegrity, compression is in there, but it is silence in the sound of a word.
Cool. And he references page 42. So while we were, took a break here, I ran to page 42 and grabbed the little map that he was talking about here. So let's see. Susan, if you want to, we ought to reread maybe. He says, see the map on page 42. And he's talking about this. Go ahead.
I'm sorry, one second. My cat is fighting me for the mouse.
What?
My cat was fighting me for the mouse.
Oh, I see. Here's the map he's referring to.
Yeah, it's talking about those trips, you know, like Phoenicians, yeah. Phoenicians.
One of the most interesting things, I think, as far as the civilization is moving on, is you start to see the trade routes and the, you know, the it's not just the exchange of goods and services, it's also the exchange of ideas, which makes these cultures actually, develop, whatever that means, even faster. And so I think that that's one of the things that if you're talking about from an evolutionary perspective, this is coming back to what we were, you know, touching upon last week. It's kind of, these types of interactions shape who we are, shape our understanding of the world. So this is this is a very important thing to document, because I think that as we go into the book a little bit further, I'm willing to bet we're going to be able to compare current day, 1982, types of trade routes and how the means of transportation versus today, or what we're reading right now. And it's going to be important to think about what Bucky principles actually applied and where within that framework. I can think of a couple, but I mean, specifically along the lines of, you know, just things like ephemeralization and things along those lines. I was in a conversation about this just the other night, the importance of trade.
Importance of what?
But the importance of trade, but specifically, you know, in developing cultures, but the importance of peacetime as well, you know, that essentially there's no conflict that is preventing trade from happening.
Yeah. Bucky's ability to just, I mean, he thinks so topologically that boggles my mind. See, I'm one of these guys that if he's going to show me a Dymaxion map with South America on the left, he should be showing me that all the time. And he has the guts to show me South America on the right today. I mean, he flips it around, and it I think it's wonderful, because it demands that my obsessive compulsive brain opens up a little bit to different ideas and different ways of looking at things. But, you know, there's a big part of me that's just not willing to do that. You know, I would rather look at a map this way all the time. Do you see what I'm saying? But now he goes backwards. And let me share with you, if I were him, I'd have solid lines everywhere the map is and dotted lines everywhere the map isn't, so that I could get some kind of bearing as to some relational distance configuration, where right
That's
now
a good point.
We're getting a good idea as to what the route is, right? And if I got it right here, I've never heard it before. The Austronesia is everything on the bottom part of this map. It's here's Australia, Indonesia, Hawaii, This is Austronesia down here. Also, it impresses me that Bucky has enough guts to say that there's a 10,000 year history of Indian Ocean crossings, which kind of like takes all the Bible guys and kind of puts it right in their face.
Steve?
Yeah.
You know, just take it from the perspective that you say there's a continuous landmass, right?
Yeah.
Okay. And what does Austro mean?
Australia. I have no idea.
Austro means south.
Oh, okay.
Austro and south is the same thing.
Okay. I never knew what Austro means.
It means south.
Cool.
So when you take your landmass, you know, whatever is south of your landmass, that is Austro. So according to that, landmass, I see that Africa would be north, isn't it? And South America would be west. Or east.
Yeah, this is a different way of looking at it.
Yeah, unless you stayed true to his first version, and I flipped it one too many times, and we just flipped it vertical, flipped it horizontal this way. Does that change the directionality of it?
No.
Okay.
No, because you're still dealing with the, at least for me, when I look at what I was telling you earlier about where India is, or Bombay, and where Calgary is in North America, and it still is a north-south route as the crow flies, so you could go over the North Pole.
Yeah.
But you want to put it on a plane, you have to put it the way it was, Steve.
Oh yeah, and it just now is registering with me, Richard. You're telling me you got an airplane in Canada and flew over the North Pole and went to India. Is that what you did?
Well, that's if I could fly like the crow. That's how you'd get from Calgary to Bombay, and they're almost a, you know, when you look at the time zone, they're 12 hours apart or 12 and a half. So they're almost halfway around the world from each other.
Yeah.
But instead of flying east to London and then south east to India,
yeah,
if I could go like the crow, I'd just fly north to the pole and south to Bombay. And then when I came home, I'd do the same thing. I'd fly north to the pole and south to Calgary.
Except as soon as you got next to that North Pole, you'd be like Admiral Byrd. We'd never hear from you again.
Yeah, either that or somebody would shoot me out of the sky. Yeah.
But it's the shortest is the shortest road because the globe is flattened. So if you take the time zones across laterally across the equator, it's longer distances. You have a compression of a globe. So if you took from Calgary, going to Europe and coming Middle East and down to Bombay, it will be very long. I've done the flight. I've flown from Western Europe to Bombay. It's already on its own long. It's long. So if you go up north, as you say, and you come down from Calgary to Bombay, is the most economical way to do.
Yeah, no, it's that's also why flying from Calgary, as an example, to London, you actually pretty much go over the North Pole.
Yes.
And that's why it's a shorter route in time-wise than it is to fly the same kind of route from, say, New York to London, because you have to go around a fatter part of the sphere.
And it's on rotation the whole time. So technically, you could just fly up in the air and sit there stationary, wait for 12 hours, and go straight back down again, and you'd be.
Yeah.
You wouldn't have to fly over the dadgum North Pole and risk your reputation with Admiral Byrd. You just stay stationary up above there and wait for the planet to rotate underneath you.
Okay, the other thing that pretty cool, and I know Bucky kind of makes us see these things, he makes them explicit, is that as much as there are these currents happening in the ocean, there are currents happening in the air. And that's one of the reasons there's just going to be areas where there's less resistance and greater flow. And there are things that I don't think of. I look at the map and I go straight line, or, oh, I know it's a curve because it's a globe, but then there's this whole other thing happening in another dimensionality of it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, in fact, I was going to mention that, Susan. So I'm glad you brought it up. The idea that I use the sails to capture the wind, and I use my rudder and the keel to capture the current. And some days I use the current. Some days, you know, I drop the sails and use the current and just float. And some days I pull up the keel and have my boat have as little mass in the water as possible and let the wind blow me. And I think that was the purpose of Kon-Tiki, because it was a raft. The Kon-Tiki ship was basically a raft that had no belly at all, and it just used the wind current.
Mm-hmm. And I was going to say that what Steve said about climbing, stationary, staying there until is mathematically strictly equivalent to the other, to flying, right? And as we're discussing, I think it was a different forum from here, the observer. You know, if you understand that, that is your macro,
mm-hmm.
and seeing the micro, from the macro seeing the micro, and zooming on to what you do. That is already a degree higher of understanding from somebody who just flies. Because that's where satellites and flying meet, to be just part of the same whole.
Cool. Okay. So I'm going to just bring page, I'm just going to make a note here. See page 42 below. And
actually, chapter two, if we stop here today, you know, next time we're going to chapter two.
Yeah.
Yeah.
10:35, yeah. So chapter two is right here. Humans and universe. All right, this is probably a good place to pause, as Manu suggests. So, Richard, how are you feeling, and what's your takeaway today?
Well, I'm feeling great. My takeaway is that I know how to tensorially get from one landmass to another. And I even learned now from you that if I hang on a flagpole on the North Pole, that I just have to wait for the Earth to bring Bombay to me. And then to Calgary.
That's right. Yeah, amazing. So how are you feeling, and what's your take? You got your takeaway, you want to pass it on to someone else?
Yeah, I'll pass it on to Susan.
Cool.
I'm sorry for joining you gentlemen late. I like being taken through the story of one of the possibilities of how this all came together. During this past week, I finished up that Simon Winchester book on Knowing What We Know, and he went over kind of his experience being on a small craft flying across or navigating across open ocean, and what it was like to have a sextant and a chronometer and the charts, and you know, just how involved it was to do this navigation. And then he took us through the story of what it was like when Sputnik got up and these researchers figured out by Doppler effect that they could figure out where Sputnik was. And then all of a sudden this mind progression of saying, well, if we can run it this way, we can run it the other way, and here's GPS. And So I love Simon Winchester taking me on some of these stories in a way. And, you know, some of it was his personal experience going through it. And so I do just like the whole idea of how do we know what we know? And, or think what we think, you know, how do we get to this spot today? And I think that's one of the things I've loved about Bucky over time is he's made, I'm a kinesthetic person. And so to start to realize that I can pull on any thread and I can start to see the shape of cycles. I remember just being blown out of the water by getting a sense of the nitrogen cycle, or to get the shape of a carbon dioxide cycle or an oxygen cycle. And, you know, Bucky always had that affinity for metals. I kind of have an affinity for some of the more biological elements. But everything just looks, precession looks really different when you shift your point of observation to the next thing. And if you ever want a hell of a ride, there's one of Michael Pollan's books called The Botany of Desire. And it looks at precession from the point of view of four different plants. So the apple, the tulip, the potato, and marijuana. And how did these plants shape us, shape our society, how we think, how we act, how we interact? And you know, we run around all the time thinking that we're the bomb. And Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy might have been right. So how do you feel, and what are you taking away?
You know, it's been a long day, but I feel pretty good. I mean, this is a great way to end the day. You know, I've had a lot of conversations today. It just came out of one actually that was talking about the history of science. And then, you know, you come in here and then you see using generalized principles to kind of where the macro and the micro kind of come together. And I'm thinking in terms of just, okay, we're looking at the trade routes, we're looking at how Bucky even looked at the way the water flowed and things along those lines. But then we think about the micro and all everything that goes into that. Like angular momentum or whatever, all these other ideas that are, you know, start to work on a micro level and what we, you know, how we can think about things. We can go from the general, from the very high level, to looking at, you know, all the interactions that we have, then we can look at special cases. And then I think that's, to me, you know, it's starting to give some structure. I did lose my copy book, which is actually kind of taking me off, from last week, and I had a lot of very good insights last week. And it's like, anyway, I'll find it, but nonetheless, that's a little bit frustrating. But other than that, I mean, it was, I enjoyed it. I really did. I think that and I'm excited to actually see what comes next, to be quite honest, as we progress through this book. So it was great to be here with everyone. Thank you, everyone, for being here. Manu, how are you feeling? What did you take away from today?
I feel good. Really, first, I'm grateful always for us committing to be here and contributing to the best that we can with that reserve. That for that, I'm really privileged to take from it. Second is from today, there are big issues for me. Susan, talking about Simon Winchester, what happened when you can't think anymore? Because it's not necessary for you to think.
He calls that digital amnesia.
Okay, so that was a big thing for me, because vertices is always our ability to think, the mind relating, that we can comprehend general principle. If it's no more necessary, what happened? All right, so the second thing that I got is this one. Okay, what is it to know about precession if you can't apply it? Or if you don't apply it, as you see, if you don't apply, because that is your decision now. What does it serve to know about it? So we should be involved so much in practical, in trying to apply what we know, what we've learned. And applying it doesn't mean that we're always going to be successful in what we try to build. Sometimes we have to discard the result that we have because we've learned more. There was a dimensionality that we didn't have, or a dimensionality that we took into account that wasn't necessary. So we have to discard that. And that is the process of learning and applying. And life is a process of building anti-entropic things. That's what life is. Even regeneration is putting them together. It's like the other guy said to the Wolfram, say, you know, you're defining the condition and then you stack it. As you're stacking up, you build gravity, and then also you go out traditionally to seeing wider. That's about the metaphor that I attached to that. So it is important for us today. And we saw globalization today. When globalization become deindustrialization, because that is the dual of the globalization as we understand it today. And all this equilibrium that we create these great trade flows that only take from one area to another area, and then create things that are superfluous in that area that are not the will, that there's no will to share or to disclose how to. And it was interesting to read, Susan, to listen to the story of a Chinese. You know, how, and Samuel Winchester talk about it. Most of the inventions of navigation came from China. Right? But they were never quoted exactly like that, because it was a narrative. And that narrative come from our local bias into believing that what is local is definitive, is just temporary. So the way Bucky approaches things allow us, or empowers us, to at least and at last be able to see from a wider perspective, and to understand that we are really, when I say global village, it doesn't mean what it is today, but that we are all dwellers of the same spaceship Earth. And Bucky say we are Earthy. And that's, to me, is the most important thing. Otherwise, I am grateful. So Steve, how do you feel? What do you take away?
Well, I'm perplexed, because I want that Dymaxion game where I can, and I've been doing Google searches here for Pacific Puzzle Company and eBay and everything. And evidently you have a classic there, Richard. And I did find Pacific Puzzle Company, but I haven't found that game yet. So, and it's pieces of wood that you actually put together, huh?
Oh, wow.
Yeah, it's hardwood. Maybe it's teak.
Maybe it's teak. I did find Pacific Puzzle Company in Washington. I saw their catalog, but it's not there. So I'm going to send them a communication, and I'll keep everybody posted on that, because I like to collect things, Bucky, especially if they don't cost an arm and a freaking leg. So, and you know, we still have a few minutes left here. So I thought, what would be more appropriate than to watch the trailer for the Contiki movie? So it's only 2 minutes. So let's have a 2-minute share of the Kon-Tiki movie trailer, which I have right here, I think. Watch the history. Okay, I thought I had it right here. I had it. Here we go. Kon-Tiki, the official trailer. Here we go. 2 minutes and 11 seconds.
Pacific. For 5,000 miles, I will prove that Peruvians were the first to settle Polynesia. It's further than from Chicago to Moscow. Look around you. Every book in here offers some theory or another.
Mr. Hardle, doubtless the story of Norwegians drowning in the Pacific will sell a lot of magazines. But not this one.
You want your theory to be accepted? Then go ahead. Drift from Peru to Polynesia on a balsa wood raft.
There will be no one to save us on that, except your theory. Groups held 1,500 years ago, and they will hold now. It looks worse than it is.
Please. Share your belief in thinking.
This is bigger than us.
I'm not hearing it, Steve.
Well, that felt like longer than 2 minutes and 11 seconds. It was beautiful. Okay, good. I'll put that link in the, I think I put the link to the IMDb, and I'll put the link to the YouTube trailer before I go. I just still think it's amazing that Bucky would put 10,000 years of history on there and defy every, biblical, I just love the fact that he looked at everything like a system. He saw a natural evolution of technology and of resources. And boy, I love that perspective. I appreciate that we have a group here that's willing to look at that stuff. And I sure appreciate all of your experiences and what you share. So I'm delighted to have been here tonight, and I'm going to go looking for that Dymaxion game. I've given my grandkids the magnets, and I've given them the map toy that is not with me right now because I'm upstairs, and I'll give them that one too. I think I like the idea of being able to put me in the center of the universe. I love that. I think that's one of the things I was so happy with Bucky about, that when he talks about cosmic integrity, not even the center of the universe. The universe is down here. Cosmic integrity is up here, and I am part of that. Me and cosmic integrity. So I don't know what any of that means, but it's fun to ponder it. So I'm just taking away the miracle of Bucky tonight, and thank you all very much. I'm complete. Anybody other last comments to go? Cool. Okay, see you all next week. Bye-bye, everybody.